You're watching BCTV. We're all about Brantford. You're watching BCTV, Brantford Government Television, a service of Brantford Community Television. This program is brought to you in part through the support of the Town of Brantford.
Call this meeting of the Brantford Planning and Zoning Commission to order. It is Thursday, May 18th, 2023. I have 7:01 p.m. I'll introduce members of the commission and staff. Joe Chadwick. Joe, are you here?
Joe Chadwick is present.
Thank you, Joe. Fred Russo. Fred, are you here?
Fred Russo, present.
Joe Viuso. Joe, are you here?
Joe Viuso, present.
Thank you, Joe. Marcy Pelosi. Marcy, are you here?
Marcy's here.
Thank you, Marcy. Massimo Liguori. Massimo, are you here?
Massimo Liguori is here.
Thank you, Massimo. Our staff this evening is Harry Smith. Harry, you're here?
I am here.
Our assistant planner, Evan Brining. Evan, you're here?
Here.
And our clerk recording secretary, lurking in the background, is Michelle Martin. I am Chuck Anders' chair. I'll ask our secretary, Fred Russo, if Fred can read the notice of public hearing.
Yes. Legal notice. The Planning and Zoning Commission of the Town of Brantford, Connecticut, hereby gives notice of public hearings to be held on Thursday, May 18, 2023 at 7 p.m. by remote technology to consider the applications listed below. Information regarding participating in the public hearings will be provided on the commission's meeting that will be posted on the town's website at least 24 hours prior to the meeting. Application number 23-4.7, special exception for grading, that's section 6.8, for a pool located at 117 Flaxmill Road, John and Jennifer Sulo, applicants and owner. Number two, application number 23-4.9, special exception for grading, section 6.8, for a recreation area located at 6 Partridge Lane, Adam Greenberg, applicant, Chris and Peck Maritoli, owner. Number three, application number 23-4.4, special exception modification for a multi-unit residential building located at 245 East Main Street, Joseph Tomorrow, applicant and owner. And number four, application 23-4.10, special exception for grading, section 6.8, for a pool located at 5 Spice Bush Lane, Matt Shahitepi, applicant and owner. At said hearings, all persons will have the right to be heard. Copies are on file in the Planning and Zoning Commission's office at the Planning and Zoning Department, 1019 Main Street, Brantford, Connecticut, 06405. Written communications may be sent to the above address or to Planning and Zoning at brantford-ct-gov. Brantford Planning and Zoning Commissioner C. Andres, chairperson.
Chuck Andres, chair. Thank you, Fred. We'll follow our normal format for public hearings, which is that the applicant will go first, make its presentation with the applicant or its consultants. After the applicant makes its presentation, we turn it over to the commission and staff. We have typically the staff will summarize the staff report on the application, and we'll open it up for questions and comments by commission members. At that point, we'll have the public portion. That'll be the public chance to participate after the commission asks its questions and we hear it from the staff report. And I'm going to ask Evan shortly to summarize how you can participate in this remote hearing. And after the public portion, we allow the applicant to respond to any public comments. We may or may not close the public hearing depending on how it goes. And so with that, Evan, can you refresh our and provide us instructions about how the applicants and public can participate?
Sure. So down at the bottom of your screen, we have a reactions button. If you select this, you can select raise your hand. Chairman Andre will ask if anybody would like to speak. You can raise your hand function or use the raise your hand function. You can type it in the chat that you'd like to speak, or you can wave your hand in front of the camera and I'll try to catch you. If you're dialing in, you can press *9 to raise your hand. And we ask that everybody please state their name at the beginning of their comment or question.
Chuck Anders Chair. Thank you, Evan. With that, we'll turn to our first public hearing item, which is Joseph Tomorrow, applicant and owner, 245 East Main Street, formerly lot between 233 and 249. This is a special exception modification for a multi-unit residential building. And I understand that we applicant has requested we open and continue this to address some staff comments that were made. Is that correct, Harry?
That is. We have an email from Jim Preddy, who's an engineer representing the applicant, and he's requested the hearing be open and continued to the next regularly scheduled meeting of the commission on June 1st.
Chuck Anders Chair. Thank you, Harry. Okay, so if you're here for item number one, we will open that matter and we will continue that to our next regular meeting, which is a remote meeting on June 1st. That brings us then to item number two, which is John and Jennifer Solo, applicants and owner, 117 Flax Mill Road, special exception for section 6.8 grading for pool. My understanding also for this one, we need to, that a variance, looks like a variance is needed. So we're gonna open and continue this matter as well. Harry, is that correct?
That is correct. Given the 35-day limit on public hearing time without a time extension, which we don't have yet from the applicant, staff is suggesting we open and continue it to the 6-1 meeting as well.
Okay. So we will open this one and continue this to our June 1st meeting as well. So if you're here on item number two, be sure to come back on June 1st. For that one, it's again, it's a remote meeting, a Zoom meeting as well. That brings us into item number three, which is Adam Greenberg, applicant Kristen Peck Martoli, owner, 6 Partridge Lane, a special exception for grading under section 6.8 for recreation area. Is the applicant ready to proceed with this?
The applicant is ready to proceed, Mr. Chairman.
You may proceed, Attorney Chance.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the Commission. I'm Attorney Marjorie Shansky. I represent Adam Greenberg, and I'm here this evening with Mr. Greenberg, with Chuck Mandel from Stevens & Associates, and I think with John Cunningham as well. This is a request under Section 6.8 of the regulations for a permit for limited excavation and grading. The genesis of this project occurred during the early months of COVID. It's related to a desire and need at the time to create recreational opportunities for the Greenbergs' 3 children. And so that is how we got started. We've been through the wetlands process and have a wetlands approval dated February 9th, 2023. I will defer to Mr. Mandel, but we'll highlight or preview coming attractions that the landscaping plan is robust, deals with indigenous plantings, and is deemed an improvement over prior conditions, and is lovely both from a buffering visual perspective, but also for resource protection for the wetlands. So with that, I guess I want to say one other thing, which is that I included in the application package a copy of David Lord's report to the Wetlands Commission, because there was absolutely no impact associated with any activity proposed with this application. So with that, Mr. Mandel, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Good evening. Chuck Mandel, agent for the applicant. As Marjorie alluded to, the Inland Wetlands Commission had put us through quite an extensive review. It took many months to get it resolved, but yet we did. There was approximately 2,900 square feet of upland review area. And when I say the upland review area, we are approximately 95 feet, probably 5 feet within the review area. So that's what triggered the wetlands. Also, the Inland Wetlands Commission, and I'm sure Evan has that, and I don't know if we could put that as an exhibit. It was a quite robust resolution decision. It was dated 2/9/23, and a lot of the conditions of that approval would be germane for tonight, for so we don't plow the same field with the Planning and Zoning Commission. I'm sure Evan can enlighten the commission as to those conditions. There was approximately 22,000 square feet of area that's within the silt fence. Evan, could you share your screen and show the site plan? I'm not very good at that stuff. So if you don't have it, that's fine. I'll just keep talking.
One second.
Okay.
Sorry about that, Chuck. I was helping some people join the meeting. Let me see. I do have the site plan up.
Okay. This is more or less an existing conditions plan that Evan will be putting up.
Do you guys see it?
Scroll down.
Yeah, we can see it.
Okay, so if you look at the map, there's a very dark line that's labeled SF. That's the silt fence that is, you bumped out, Evan, if you get the map back on.
Oh, you're on the wrong tab.
You have the agenda.
Sorry, guys. I'm sorry, what happened?
Somehow we end up with a view of the agenda, Evan, instead of the plan.
Sorry.
Oh, that's okay. You're doing better than I would. So that dark line was the silt fence, and that's approximately, it's over 22,000 square feet of area. That's the recreation area. In regards to the cutting, we did an evaluation of the trees that were taken down. They were varying sizes. It was a forested area. Lightly forested area, typical of most subdivisions in that area. There were some trees that were taken down and the stumps were removed. There was very little grading. The area was very flat to begin with, and that's why that was chosen. He started to install a basketball court, sport court area, and also a batting cage, which is also shown on the plan. Once Evan gets it back on, we are providing a rain garden to capture any runoff from the batting cage, which is like an astroturf material. It's we called it an impervious surface, yet it will absorb some water. The rain garden is going to be it'll accommodate the runoff from those two areas, and the computations are on the plan. And in addition, the cuts and fills on the rain garden, they're almost equal. So we'll be bringing in about 4 cubic yards of fill to create the berm to retain some of that water. John Cunningham also provided, along with Dave Lord, quite an extensive planting plan, and that is also was part of the application material. So if there are any questions, I'll be glad to answer any.
Sure. Thank you, Mr. Mandel. Evan, can you pull up the plan?
The landscaping plan?
Just the plan, the site plan.
I think the site plan would be a little bit better, easier to understand.
Sorry about that, guys. Doing two things at once.
No offense to John Cunningham, but this is easier to read. Okay, so like I said earlier, that dark line was the silt fence. And that was the area that we're proposing a grass mixture, and also the light green area to the right, that is the proposed rain garden. and you can see the proposed grades. So the proposed grades are the darker lines. You see 82, 84, 86, and that would be the proposed grading. There's also a cross section on the plan that shows the proposed depth of the rain garden. And there's the basketball court and the batting cage also show on there.
And where is the dwelling? It's probably, we can't see it, right?
Because if you zoom out, the dwelling's right there.
Okay.
So there's a walkway down to that path. That was the construction entrance, but that will be used as the access and egress through the site. It's fairly steep on the other side where you can see the contour lines are very, very tight. That's a very steep area right there.
So Chuck Anders here. So basically it's a basketball court and a batting cage?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
It is. And you can also see the wetlands boundary line. Those are those blue little triangles that are along there. And that the 100-foot review zone is shown also. And as you can see, there was about 2,900 square foot of disturbance, which will be mitigated.
Chuck Hayes, Chair. Thank you.
Yes.
Evan, do you want to summarize the staff report?
Hi, this is Marcy. Can I ask a question first?
Sure, absolutely. I was going to have that. Go ahead.
Two things. I noticed that there's a line that says conservation restriction that falls outside of the upland review area. Was that put into place at the time of the subdivision? And then my other question is, what's the grade of the walkway? And the third question is, does the grade of the basketball court, it looks like it's draining away from the upland review area to the rain garden and then circling back around sort of the long way around the area that was cleared. Is that correct?
Chuck Mandel, I'm going to defer to Marge Shansky for the conservation easement question.
It's a conservation restriction. This is Marjorie Shansky, and it is a conservation restriction. It was on at the time of the subdivision. And included within its terms, the ability to obtain wetlands relief for diverse purposes, among which were these. So I hope that's responsive to your question.
Chuck Anders, who was it in favor of, Ms. Shansky? Who was the grantee of the easement?
There was no grantee. That's why it's not an easement, it's a conservation restriction.
Okay, so was it part of the subdivision, is that correct? Or what?
It's part of the subdivision, but there's no grantee. It's sort of a declaration, really.
Okay, and my understanding is that this is in conformance, the terms of the conservation restriction authorized relief via wetlands, and you've obtained that? Is that your position or what?
That is the circumstance.
Okay.
And was broadly vetted in front of the Wetlands Commission.
Okay.
There it is. Yeah.
Marcy, again, I find it odd that the restriction wasn't following the line of the upland review area personally. And I'm hoping that you could answer the other two questions, which would be the grade of the driveway and just confirm that the basketball court is draining away from that tip of the wetland toward the rain garden.
Yeah, Chuck Mandel here. So you can see the conservation restriction is not coincident with the 100-foot review. It's actually it's a straight line that continues used from property line to property line, but it is not coincident with the 100-foot review zone. In regards to the basketball court, it is draining. It's at the 89.3, and there's a bit of a high point of 90, so it does drain to the rain garden, and it's about a 10% slope from the house down to the basketball court area.
Thank you.
Chuck Anders, Chair. Evan, do you want to go ahead and summarize your staff report?
Yes, sure. I apologize if I repeat anything that Attorney Shansky or Chuck Mandel had said. As I said, I was helping some people try to join the meeting. So the already completed activity consists of the clearing of around 21,000 square feet of vegetation towards the rear of the property for basketball court and batting cage. They also propose the installation of a rain garden. They meet the requirements of the R5 district. They have submitted a landscaping plan, which I can bring up for you guys if you would like. They meet the parking requirements. No lighting was noted on the plan. I had originally introduced just a standard that would require compliance with section 6.7, but this afternoon I had added an additional condition that would prohibit any lighting in the conservation restriction area, especially down by the batting cages in the basketball court. They did not provide an erosion and soil control plan. However, erosion control measures were added to the site plan. You can see the silt fence around the border of the activity. They meet the slope requirements and no stockpile area was noted. However, the activity was mainly already completed. The applicant received Inland Wetland Commission approval on February 9th, 2023. And based on the application materials, it seems that they satisfy the special exception criteria of section 9.8. Staff recommends one finding that the applicant has expressed to staff that the location of the silt fence shows the limit of disturbance. And we have four total conditions, the first of which is that prior to construction, erosion control measures shall be installed and maintained throughout construction to the satisfaction of the zoning enforcement officer. Our second condition would require any lighting on the site to be compliant with section 6.7. And no outdoor lighting shall be permitted for the proposed batting cage, basketball court, or the remainder of the area within the conservation restriction area, as depicted on sheet C1 entitled Improvement Location Survey. And our final condition is that this approval does not include any use of the site beyond that associated with a single family dwelling as defined by the town of Brantford zoning regulations.
Chuck Anders here. Thank you, Evan. Questions, comments from commission members? Hearing none, then let's open it up for public comment. Are any members of the public wish? Whoops. Question, comments from someone? Did I hear something? Okay, let's, Evan?
I'm sorry, did you ask for public comment, Chuck?
Yeah, I was about to. I thought I heard someone speaking. I didn't know if it was a commission member. So any member of the public wish to comment, Evan, I'll let you handle that.
Sure, so down at the bottom of your screen, once again, you can select the reactions button and you can select raise your hand if you'd like to participate. You can also indicate that you would like to speak in the chat. And if you're calling in, you press *9 to raise your hand to indicate that you'd like to speak. First up, we look like we have Brendan Morrissey. Mr. Morrissey?
Hey, everyone. Thanks for letting me speak. I am a friend of the Greenbergs, and I fully support the this land being used for recreational field and basketball court. I think it'd be great for the kids and friends of the Greenbergs. And again, I fully support it. Thank you.
Chuck, well,
I live in Brantford on Knollwood Drive.
Thank you, Mr. Morris. Who's next, Evan?
Looks like we have somebody who phoned in that would like to participate.
Hello?
You're unmuted, sir.
Okay. This is Mike and Joan Lang. We live directly behind the Greenbergs. Our principal concern is actually the runoff and how that's going to be attended to. I don't know if you guys have seen the property itself, but when we moved in here 23 years ago, the runoff was principally going southeast into the culvert and into the wetland. Now the way that the runoff appears, it's going to be coming directly into our property and our neighbor's property. So I don't know if you've already discussed that. I don't have access to the chart you're looking at, so just bear with me, if you will. But if you could, maybe you've already addressed that.
Well, when you finish your comments, I'll ask Mr. Mandel, the applicant's engineer, to address the runoff issue.
That's principally it, and I do appreciate the note on the lighting, because like I said, we live directly behind them, and any evening lighting would shine right on our properties.
Okay, thanks. Thank you. Chuck Anders, Chair. Mr. Mandel, can you address the neighbor's concern about runoff?
Yes, that's specifically why we did create the rain garden, is to have a 0% increase in runoff. We will be capturing any additional runoff from the batting cage and also from the basketball court. In addition, the entire area is going to be lawn, which is going to be relatively flat. And the existing runoff now was actually, there's that 90, so it was we're not affecting any of the drainage patterns. We're going to be maintaining the same drainage patterns that were present. Like I said, the rain garden will be capturing any additional runoff from any of the impervious surface of the batting cage and the basketball court. We treated them as being impervious, with no perviousness, which batting cage, I believe, does have a ratio of perviousness, but we did not include that in our calculations.
Okay, so
thank you, Mr. Mandel.
So for all intents and purposes, the runoff will be pretty much status quo.
That is correct, sir.
Okay. All right, that's our principal concern.
Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yes. Other members of the public wish to comment? Evan?
Yes. Next up, we have Becky Gilman.
Yeah, hi there. Becky Gilman from Ivy Street, Friends of the Greenbergs. Just wanted to put my comment in that I'm in favor, and I'm absolutely for going ahead with this project for the private recreation project on the Greenbergs property. I think anything that could get the kids outside and playing and not in front of screens, and everything seems like it's going through the proper channels. So I just wanted to give my 100% vote of confidence for this, and I hope it goes through.
Chuck, can you share? Thank you, Ms. Gilman. Evan, other public members?
Yes, next person is just labeled as iPhone. So please ask them to state their name. It's there on there.
Yes, hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, my name is Mark Vandenbroek. I'm also a friend of the Greenbergs. I live on Buttermilk Lane, probably less than 5 minutes from the Greenbergs property. And I too just wanna throw my full support behind the project. I have two sons who are about the same age as the Greenbergs children. And you know, I know they would benefit greatly from being able to go over there and play with their boys. You know, I think overall, just for the community, the Greenbergs have a large network of friends who absolutely would benefit from this. So I do just want to say how much I support the project. Thank you.
Chuck Anders, Chair, thank you. Other members of the public wish to comment? Evan, you seen anyone?
We did get some comments in the chat from Flax Mill Commons. I would like to give them the opportunity to unmute themselves and speak. But in that chat, they asked, can you explain how you will confirm that this remediation plan is fully executed? And do we contact the commission if lighting is installed in the future or other violations? Thank you. You can certainly call the Planning and Zoning Department and submit any complaints to our zoning enforcement officers. And we can go out to the site and make sure that there's any zoning regulations from our code book that we can enforce.
Chuck Kendrick, Chair, thank you. Evan.
Yeah, Chuck Mandel here, if I can answer that. So the wetlands resolution was very precise and exactly what that the concerns are. They will be monitored very closely for the plantings. We have Dave Lord, involved, and along with John Cunningham, and also your section 6.8 is final as-built plan is required. So that will be forthcoming to the commission.
Checking to share. Thank you, Mr. Mandel. Evan, are there other members of the public who wish to comment?
I do not see anyone else.
Okay. One more time, any member of the public also wish to comment?
Chuck, Fred Russo.
Fred, absolutely.
With the assumption that all the regulations are met, I think it's a kind of a good idea where a property owner can come out and provide something outdoors instead of indoors for kids to play. And it's not just one or two kids. It could be three or four. It kind of almost brings back the old sense of a neighborhood where, you know, when I was a kid, that's where we were outside. There was no inside activities to do. So I think in principle, I love that idea that someone's willing to go out there and develop part of their property, not for themselves, you know, whatever, but for their kids. I think it's a wonderful thing. So that's my thought.
Great. Chuck Andrews here. Thank you, Fred. Other comments from commission members?
Massimo Liguori here.
How Massimo?
Yeah, I'm going to kind of double up on that with what Fred said. I think, you know, hats off to the Greenbergs. They getting these kids outside, keeping them active from being, you know, kind of tied up and captured in the house after the last few years that what these children had to deal with. I think it's a wonderful idea. And I really liked the rain garden there. I thought that was brilliant. So hats off to you guys. I think it's a great idea. Thank you.
Chuck Innister, thank you, Massimo. Any other comments from commission members?
Marcy Bluzy here.
Marcy.
I realize that they cleared some trees, but I just want to make note that they cleared it outside of the upland review area. I was just curious how many large trees might have been in that smaller area that was you know, needed to open up the space. I'm having a hard time understanding the purpose of the conservation restriction and why it would be beyond the upland review area. I don't know if you could provide any history to that or any feedback of how the wetlands handled the application, but that might, you know, reconcile the discrepancy to me anyways.
Harry Smith, town planner. Marcy, I took a quick look through the old subdivision file. And there were actually two of them, as they modified. I think it expired and they had to reapply and get it reapproved. And could really not find anything in terms of where what the genesis of the conservation restriction was, whether it was a result of some discussion at wetlands or it just was offered by the property owner who developed the property. I really don't know. And there was no record that we could see in the file.
Chuck Innister, Harry, is it fair to say that the conservation restriction wasn't a requirement of the subdivision?
I think it's fair to say that it was on the subdivision plan, but the open space was what was required. And that was, you know, in another area distinct from the lot. It's not contiguous to it at all. So,
okay. Yeah.
Seems to be something completely separate.
Yeah. I mean, it's if it was a requirement of the subdivision approval and they violated it, then in theory, they're in violation of a condition of the subdivision. But it appears that it wasn't a condition of approval of the original subdivision. So, you know, it's right. Not a subdivision violation. I mean, I don't know. That's what it would appear to be.
Yeah. So for me, it seems like it lacks basis. I'm not hearing any environmental or ecological reason for runoff or anything like that as to why that was created. I mean, you can see in another area where there's a drainage easement, you know, but these are all things that are encumbering the landowner and, you know, affecting their ability to, you know, use their property. And that just gives me pause, you know, because, you know, I know we, you know, that 100-foot line is, you know, heavily enforced. And it seems like this is just creeping even further past, and I just don't really see what the basis is for, you know, causing the homeowner those restrictions, unless there's something, like I said, unless there's something ecologically that I'm missing that it was needed for. So.
Sure, I can share. Thank you, Marcy. Other comments from commission members?
Chuck, we do have some additional members of the public that would like to speak.
Okay, we'll go ahead. Who we got?
We have Brian's iPhone, and we also have a comment from the chat from John Foley that he is in full support of the project. But Brian, if you could please state your full name.
Sure, it's Brian Davey. You guys hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay, cool. Yeah, no, I'm fully support, you know, what the Greenbergs are doing. I've, you know, known them for quite some time, and having, you know, young kids out here in Brantford, I think, you know, being able to have somewhere out like a nice field to get the kids out there, get them outside and, you know, off of their electronics. I mean, I just think it's a good thing. And, you know, it's really for the kids. So I'm fully in favor of it. And I really hope that this can go through, because it's, you know, it's not for anything but for the kids. So that's all I wanted to say. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. That's it, right, Evan, for public comment?
I do not see anyone else.
Okay. And we've heard from commission members, Attorney Shansky. Any further comments from you or your team?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Marjorie Shansky. For the record, I simply want to indicate that the silt fence was in entirely through the entire wetlands process. So I don't think that it's being introduced. I think it's been there for quite some time. But I appreciate that additional soil erosion sediment controls will be joining, and that the wetlands approval and all of its conditions will give great assurance to all about the completion of the project as proposed. With that, Mr. Chairman, and a reference to the special exception criteria, this is an entirely appropriate recreational use associated with the residential property, and we're gratified by the number of friends that the Greenberg children have, and thank you for your time, and urge your approval. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Shansky. Any further questions?
Can I say one thing?
Certainly, yeah. Mr. Greenberg.
Adam Greenberg, property owner. I just want to say my appreciation to the committee members for giving me the opportunity to speak in front of you guys tonight. Everyone who has shown support of the project and those who have had questions. We took it very seriously to make sure all the neighbors, nothing was impacted negatively towards them. And again, just to echo what Mr. Russo and Mr. Liguori were really speaking about, and some of the members, this is for the kids. That's it. I mean, I had my opportunity. I started in Guilford, and I was swinging a bat 300 times a day, and I made it up to the pinnacle of Major League Baseball. And boy, was it a life-changing experience. But sports in general for kids, it's about learning and lessons and growing and being a part of a community and not being playing Fortnite all night, because that's what my kids have been doing, and talking to kids all over the world. Being with the kids and outside, there's nothing greater for these kids to have that opportunity. So for me, that's what it's all about. It's always been about that. So again, just appreciation to all of you for hearing that. And hopefully we can get this approved and give these kids the opportunity that they deserve.
Chuck, thank you, Mr. Greenberg. I certainly hope the kids have better luck when they get in the batting cage than when you had with your first pitch at the with the Cubs. So
We're practicing getting out of the way. We're practicing right. Getting out
he's
of the
like,
way.
He's like over the top.
Right.
No wonder.
So in any event, is there anyone else from your team, Ms. Shansky? Any further comments?
No, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, and any further comments by Commissioner
Chuck?
Okay, so I think that I think we can close this matter as a public hearing, and we can take it up shortly.
Very good.
Okay, so that's it for item number two, or item number three, excuse me. Item number four is Matt Santipe, applicant owner, and 5 Spice Bush Lane. a special exception for grading. Is the applicant ready to proceed with that one?
Yes. Harry, could you make, Matt is under the name Hikmet iPhone.
Yep. Oh, okay. That's what I was wondering. Okay. Gotcha.
Hello. Guys, you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Hello. Hi. My name is Matt Saintefer. So I'm the owner of the applicant. So I am going to do the pool 18 feet around and height is 52 inch. It's my backyard. I have a kids can play, enjoy the summertime, the play with the pool. Better than staying home, play video gaming. So that's it.
Thank you. Evan, you want to review the staff report with us?
Sure. So like Matt had described for us, the activity consists of regrading a portion of the rear yard for the installation of an above ground pool. It appears that the applicant meets the bulk requirements for the R4 district. They certainly meet the setback requirements. However, no zoning table was provided, but I can only assume that the applicant meets the lot coverage standard. I have added a condition that prior to a building permit being issued for the pool, the applicant shall have his surveyor confirm that that is the case. And the applicant has confirmed that he would be able to do that for us. No lighting was proposed on the plans, but I've introduced that standard that would require all lighting to meet the requirements of section 6.7. No erosion control plan was submitted. However, they do have some silt fencing here. You can see around the area of activity and around the pool. The applicant meets the slope requirements. And no stockpile has been added to the plan. They received approval from the Inland Wetland Commission's agent on May 1st. And based on the application material, it appears that they satisfy the special exception criteria. Staff recommends three conditions, the first of which is prior to the start of construction, erosion control measures shall be installed. The second one is that all lighting shall be compliant with section 6.7. And then the last of which is that prior to the issuance of a building permit, the applicant shall confirm the proposed activity will be compliant with the 25% lot coverage maximum.
Chuck Kander's chair. Thank you, Evan. Questions, comments from commission members before we open up to the public? Hearing none, let's open up to the public. Does any member of the public wish to comment? Evan, you see anyone?
No, but I'd just like to reiterate, down at the bottom of your screen, there is a reactions button. You can select that, and then you can further select raise hand. And that you can also type into the chat that you'd like to participate. I do not see anyone at this time.
Okay, so we'll close the public portion. Does the applicant have any further comments?
No, thank you so much.
And does any member of the commission or staff have any further comments? Seeing none, then we'll close this matter as a public hearing. And again, this is something I think we can take up in a little bit. So. Thank you, Matt. That closes our public hearings. So it brings us into our minutes from our last meeting of May 4th, which I believe were emailed to us. Commission members had a chance to review those? And if so, does someone want to make an appropriate motion with respect to the minutes?
Joe Vayuso moves to approve the minutes.
Motion made by Joe Vayuso to approve the minutes. Is there a second?
Chadwick seconds.
Second by Joe Chadwick. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Joe Chadwick, are you in favor?
Joe Chadwick is in favor.
Fred Russo?
Fred Russo in favor.
Joe Vayuso?
Vayuso in favor.
Marcy?
Marcy's in favor.
And Chair is also in favor. So we approve the minutes. Any correspondence, Harry?
Harry Smith, town planner. No, we have no correspondence this meeting.
Okay. So then let's go back to the public hearing items that we may be able to act on. The first one is the Adam Greenberg, 6 Partridge Lane special exception for grading. The batting cage and basketball court in the backyard. Evan has pulled this up. Any comments from commission members? Seems generally in compliance. I think the people, commission members, have expressed on the record that it's good, healthy thing for the children. I think the concern, I like the idea of the no outdoor lighting for the concern for the neighbors. If there were any changes about that, anyone could always come in, but I think that's where it should be. It looks good to me. Any thoughts or comments from anyone?
Chuck, Fred Russo, I agree with you. I think it's a good thing when we can get our kids out of the house and provide something like this. Look, to do what Mr. Greenberg is going to do is not going to be an inexpensive item. You know, it's not putting up a little jungle gym. So if he's going to go out and he's going to do that and he's going to positively affect the future of young men and young girls would be playing as well, I think it's a good idea. I really enjoy it. I like the idea of what he wants to do there. So I would be in favor of it.
Great. Thanks, Fred. Anyone else? Any have comments?
Hi, this is Marcy. I think that homeowners should have the right to, develop the property with the reason of protecting the environment and so forth. And that's why I was particularly focused on that restriction, because, as it is, the upland review area is heavily controlled and looked at as it, as it should be. I understand that. But, I heard no basis as to why that, or history as to why that conservation restriction was put there. And, I just think that that's an additional burden on the homeowner. That being said, I encourage or endorse that they did the necessary steps to use native plantings, to hire a landscape architect to propose some replacement trees to be good stewards of the land. And, I'm certainly in favor of it.
Great. Chuck Anderson. Thank you, Marcy. I think those are all great points. Yeah, it's interesting where this restriction came from. It doesn't appear it was part of the subdivision. Maybe it came out of wetlands, but I gather they went through a fairly rigorous wetlands review process. And there is some intersection between, this is just a 6.8, which is earth removals close to wetlands that triggers the zoning thing. So there is somewhat some duplication, but like you pointed out, there's some fairly rigorous landscape plan and professionals that have reviewed it. So looks good. Any other thoughts or comments from anyone?
Massimo Liguori here. I'm probably, I don't think I'm going to be voting on this one here, but the way I feel about, when homeowners want to put certain activities out and then they have the means to do it for children, there's just nothing more important than, I think, getting the children out there. I think it's a great idea. And I really hope this goes through with ease. And I wish more people could do things like this. And I'm sure they would if they had the means to. But it's a wonderful idea getting kids outside. I have, three grown kids now. And, we spent our time outside. And I just think, it's important. It's important for children's development. It's important for the neighborhood. It's important for the whole town. And I give it my full support. That's about it. Thank you.
Chuck Anderson. Thank you, Massimo. Anyone else? If not, does someone want to make a motion to approve the application with the findings and conditions in the revised staff report that Evan has projected on the screen in front of us?
Fred Russo, so moved.
Motion made by Fred. Is there a second?
Chadwick seconds.
Second by Joe Chadwick. Any further discussion? All those in favor, Mr. Chadwick?
Chadwick is in favor.
Fred Russo?
Fred Russo, yes, in favor.
Joe Valuzzo.
Joe Valuzzo in favor.
Marcy Pelosi.
Marcy's in favor.
And the chair is also in favor. So that application is approved. So
thank you.
Yes, good luck, Mr. Greenberg. And that brings then to item number four, which is Mr. I how do you pronounce the last name? I'm sorry, I'm gonna massacre that, Evan. Do you know what the correct pronunciation? for the 5 Spicebrook Lane special exception?
Tahin Tepe.
Okay. So for that application then, for Evan, can you, has pulled up the staff recommendation for the findings and conditions. Again, we didn't hear anything from the public on this. It looks fairly straightforward. Any anyone wish to make any comments on this one? Not then, does someone want to make a motion to approve the application with the three conditions set forth in the staff report that Evan has projected in front of us?
Chadwick will make that motion.
Motion made by Joe Chadwick. Is there a second?
Fred Russo seconds.
Second by Fred. Further discussion? All those in favor? Joe Chadwick?
Joe Chadwick is in favor.
Fred Russo?
Fred Russo in favor.
Joe Valluzzo?
Valluzzo in favor.
Marcy Pelosi?
Marcy's in favor.
And the chair is also in favor, so that application is approved.
So much.
Chuck, you're muted.
Excuse me, I don't know what happened there. Chuck Anders chair. That brings us into old business. Item number one is the McDonald's application, 424-436 West Main Street. Just ask staff where we stand on that. Harry, you're muted.
Thank you. Harry Smithtown Planner. I believe the consensus of the commission was to approve this at the last meeting. This, as you know, was subject to a peer review, and the cost of that peer review per Town Orange is to be paid by the applicant. And the Town Orange actually specifies that's to be paid prior to the decision being rendered by the commission. So staff would recommend tabling any further decision on the application to the 6, maybe 15 meeting, because so we'd have consistent voting in terms of the members that were present on the public hearing. That would be, I guess, you, Chuck. Mm-hmm. We're not going to be here on the first. So that'd be our recommendation. Hopefully by then we'll have the payment in hand and can go ahead.
Okay. Chuck Anderson, thank you. I know, Evan, you worked on the staff report. I didn't. Has anyone been in touch with the applicant about getting paid, or is it checks in the mail or whatever? No.
I spoke to the attorney this morning, and they said, McDonald's is preparing it. And I think it's just a matter of having certain people within the company responsible for certain payments. So just a few more channels it has to run through before it gets to us.
Okay. So it's a big corporation and a nice bureaucracy, but since the ordinance specifies that we should be paid before we render a decision, we probably should wait. That's what the law requires. So, but it sounds like it's a straightforward approval, basically. Is that correct?
Not many conditions. I think most of the issues that we had discussed, at least the site plan issues, they had made those changes, the bollards, the fence, the payment for the peer review is really the only remaining issue.
Okay, great. Okay, so we'll table item number one of the old business until we receive our check. And then that's probably something we can take up. Item number two of old business. Again, we've got a public hearing scheduled for June 15th. That's the zoning regulation for landscaping. Item number three is a 4-lot re-subdivision. We have also a public hearing scheduled for the 15th. And item number four, looks like a public hearing scheduled for our next meeting on June 1st. Is that correct? Anything else, Eric?
Harry Smithtown Planner, that's all correct. I just wanted to possibly clarify. So do you want to table it to the next meeting? This is McDonald's, or the meeting on the 15th, where I think everyone who was present on the public hearing would be available.
I'm missing the next meeting.
Right. Exactly. Right.
Yeah. My kid's getting married, and you know what? Something's take priority over zoning. So
as hard as it is to believe, right?
Yeah, I know it. I know it. Who would have thought?
Okay, so to the 15th then. All right. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, and it sounds like they're not moving that fast either. So probably take that long.
Okay.
Okay, that brings us into new business. I have number five. I guess it should be number one, actually, but it's
Premium. It should be number one, right.
Realty Holdings, applicant and owner, care of Robert Albine, 132 Ivy Street. This is special exception site plan modification. Harry, or do you want to review?
I haven't represented the applicant here. I just made a co-host, Dan Limburton. Dan, I don't know if you want to quickly describe the changes in the approved site plan, which I can put up for the commission while you're talking, if you'd like. Let me go find Dan. You should be, I think you're unmuted now. Can't hear anything. So I'm going to go ahead and just describe it. So you should be able to see his site plan. This was originally approved in, I believe, 2021 in April. There was a building on the site that was knocked down, another building constructed here, parking on the south side of the site. This area is to be a gravel parking area and a couple of, I believe, a handicap parking space up here and a rear access into the interior of the building, some trees along the front, more landscaping in the corner here. There is an existing chain link fence that was kept, a couple of trees here in front of the building, two on the south side on the side yard planting area, dumpster over here, tree behind it, and a tree in a parking lot island. In developing the site, it made sense to make some changes to the, in terms of the construction company and their view of it and talking to the owner. So this is how it was constructed. They moved the parking lot island, which was about here, to be located right where the chain link fence was cordoning off majority of the parking area. They are now proposing to put a service very, very large shrub here, native, in place of a white oak. They had previously, through a minor site plan approval, shoved the whole site, the parking and the building footprint, about 5 feet to the north, which is this direction, to avoid disturbing this slope, which is pretty steep and has some existing vegetation on it. So following on that, they really don't want to get in there and plant the two white oaks. They think it would basically do more harm than good by disturbing the slope. And there are existing saplings. I have a couple of pictures can show you in a minute of what the area looks like. They also didn't want to have the dumpster here, which would require the truck to cross two parking spaces to get to it. So they relocated it up here and was basically on the back out area for parking spaces. You know, the handicapped space, I think you can back out and get around that. So I don't think that's a problem. There is a problem with this space though. The zoning regulations require a 20-foot deep maneuvering aisle, a vehicle aisle behind parking spaces. Just to give you a little more background here, the number of parking spaces here is not really from the table in the zoning regulations. It was just established de facto by the approval. There's no magic number here. There are not customers coming to the site. My understanding is it's a detailing car washing facility, mostly detailing in conjunction with the Premier Subaru dealership, so that they will be having cars over here driven by staff of the dealership. And there probably will be some inventory parked here as well. So there won't be people coming in here. And of course, this is all going to be cordoned off with a chain link fence. So there are a few spaces here available if needed, but this is not going to be that kind of situation. So I propose the way to get around that. I mean, I think the commission would just simply, since this was a use not listed in the parking table, there's a provision where the commission can designate what the appropriate parking standard should be. I calculated that out. If we drop it, you know, to what would be with that one space out, I think that would take care of it, allow that one space to be removed from the plan. and you could go through an approval, having it be in compliance otherwise with the regulations. They did change, this area is all loamed and seeded currently. In looking at, you know, this back area here, whether it made sense to have grass there. This was all going to be gravel anyway, so having a grass strip behind it and over here didn't make a lot of sense. So they're proposing to have all of this as gravel. And the area of loaming and seeding would be as it's shown in front here, and it'd be gravel in front of all these two sides of the building as well, actually three sides. So those are the changes being proposed. Hopefully, Dan, I'm not missing anything.
Hi, Harry. Sorry about that. I was having issues with my microphone on my laptop, apparently.
I thought it might be something like that. So hopefully you caught everything I said. I just reviewed everything that was being proposed. And
I did, yep.
I put forward for all the changes I think were pretty accurate to what you told me.
Yes, sir. Yeah, you nailed it. So
okay. So there is that. I have a staff report I wrote up late this afternoon, which I didn't get off to the commission, so I apologize, but frankly, you probably wouldn't have a chance to read it anyway. It goes through everything I just talked about and proposes a couple of findings to follow up with. First of all, waiver of the public hearing requirement. We did not advertise this because it wasn't time. That's provided for in the regulations. The changes really individually are minor in nature. I frankly, as staff, don't think they materially alter the special exception. So we're proposing this finding for the commission's consideration. And here is the finding about the parking standard. So when I did the calculation, it came out to roughly one space per 300 square feet. So I've bumped that up a little just to be safe. You know, this is just basically picking a number out of thin air that relates to what the applicant's proposing they need. But it does reference section of the zoning regulations in table note one that allows the commission to pick a standard basically for a use for which no parking standard is provided in the table. So there's that. And also going back to the plan, on the south side here, there were these two trees, but in the modified landscaping plan, they're removed. And again, as I mentioned, there really is enough vegetation there. And I will try and pull up a couple of pictures if you'd like to see them. Stop sharing here for a second. This will take me a second here. All right. Whoa. Okay, so everyone should be able to see this email from Zoning Enforcement Officer Jane Ellis. She and the Inland Wetlands agent were at the site. And by the way, this did receive approval from Inland Wetlands staff today. So we have that record in the file. Because there is a small offsite wetland in the upland review area for that wetland is on part of the property and part of the changes are within that area. So you can see this is looking south from the site, right where the fences and a new parking lot island is located. You can see the vegetation here on the side. Again, another shot, there's a couple of larger trees, and I think it looks like even a pine tree in there. That, I believe, is looking west. That's Jamie Frederick, also a former zoning enforcement officer, now the Inland Wetlands director. And this is looking, I believe, south. So you can see some vegetation in that area.
Correct area, yes, that's south, yeah.
Okay. So we have all those pictures, and I think that demonstrates what's there on that side slope. While I've got this here, actually, I've stopped sharing that. And just in terms of the dumpster itself, there is an existing fence around it. which has a these sort of constructed with a privacy screening built in that's on all four sides. That's butting up against the adjoining property here, which you can sort of see sideways, which is also commercial use, but it's basically a just a parking area for boats and other kind of model vehicles and debris, et cetera, at more of this current time. So let me stop that. Are you actually seeing anything at this point, or did I lose you there?
You're not sharing. Oh, now you are.
Okay. So there's the dumpster screening, which is same thing, all four sides. All right. Let me get rid of that and go back to the report. So you should be able to see the staff report in front of you. Yes?
Yes.
Okay. So I have those three post findings. Conditions include the parking space that I talked about up in the corner there that you'd have trouble backing out of to be eliminated. With the finding regarding the parking standard that would provide for that to be done without violating compliance of the parking requirements. Also, this was only one sheet of a set of plans that were approved back in April 2021. So, and number two, asking that all the other sheets of the plan that show the building and the parking layout be modified to match this one sheet that was modified and submitted this morning. And number three, all previous approvals remain in full force and effect as they still apply. So that's it. I don't, Dan, do you want to add anything?
No, sir. I think you pretty much hit it on the head.
Okay.
Great. Chuck Anders, Chair. Okay. So this is appears to be a fairly minor modification to an existing approved special exception for the Premier Subaru, where they do their detailing. Any questions or comments from commission members about this? If there are none, then I think the first thing would be, and assuming, yes.
Hi, it's Marcy.
Marcy.
I'm going to put on my video. I just wanted to say, I think this is a perfect example of, you know, not minutia, but small details that, you know, don't affect the intent of the special exception and, you know, could have perhaps been handled administratively. I don't know if that other people agree, but, you know, I think Harry even said that, you know, he had some technical things that he had to just, you know, put language to, but it really, as it affects the special exception, nothing's unusual or significantly altered, in my opinion. Maybe other people don't feel that way, but I just kind of wanted to throw that out there.
Great. Check answer. Thank you, Marcy. I think they are fairly minor. It did remove a couple of trees, and sometimes we're concerned when trees get removed. And the reason there were slopes in the vegetation, and you documented the existing vegetation that is in that sloped area. And so I don't, but I understand. I agree this is fairly minor. So, that's what I think that's the intent here. So we can hopefully vote and get this off our agenda. So, but any other thoughts or comments?
Harry Smith, town planner. Yeah, I would have done it myself if it wasn't for the need for the findings about the removing the, you know, number three, respect to the existing vegetation being sufficient to, it should be two instead of toe. To allow the removal of the two white oaks, they previously approved the plant there and the parking issue, so.
Thanks, Harry. Any other thoughts or comments from anyone? If not, then does someone, I think we do two motions. First is make a motion to waive the public hearing with respect to this application. Someone want to make that motion?
Fred Russo makes that motion.
Motion made by Fred, is there a second?
Seconds.
Second by Joe Baiuzzo. Any further discussion? All in favor of waiving the public hearing. Joe Chadwick? Joe? I think you're muted. I'm sorry, Joe. No, it looks like you're still muted.
Where is he?
Joe Chadwick.
I apologize. My mouse stuck.
Okay. Oh.
So, Chadwick is in favor.
Great. Thank you, Joe. Fred Russo?
Fred Russo is in favor.
Joe Van Uzo?
Russo in favor.
Marcy? Marcy, you're muted too. I'm sorry.
Marcy's in favor.
And Chair's also in favor. Okay. So we waived the public hearing. Okay, so Harry, you want to just put the staff recommendation up there again?
Sure. So again, we have three findings. The first, waiving the public hearing, which, you know, you voted to do that already, so you can get rid of that if you wanted to. Number two, establishing a parking standard of one parking space per 350 square feet of gross floor area for an automobile washing, lubricating, and or detailing facility per the requirements in that stated section of the regulations. And finding three would be the commission finds sufficient existing vegetation along the south side yard to meet all landscaping requirements and can change toe to two and conditions 1, 2, and 3 as I described before.
Thank you, Harry. So someone may make a motion that we approve this site plan special exception modification by adopting the staff report with the three findings and three conditions.
Chadwick will make that motion.
Motion made by Joe Chadwick. Is there a second?
Fred Russo will second.
Fred seconds. Any further discussion? All those in favor, Joe Chadwick?
Chadwick is in favor.
Fred Russo?
Fred Russo in favor.
Joe Bayuso?
Bayuso in favor.
Marcy?
Marcy's in favor.
And Chair is also in favor. Okay, that brings us into old business, other business rather. The first is a bond establishment for 132 Ivy Street.
Harry Smith, town planner. This was a fallback in case you did not go ahead and approve the application. So we did have teed up a bond amount to basically convert the site back to what was approved under the two-year-old site plan to allow them to go ahead and get a TCO. But since you just approved the last application, you don't need to do this. We can just skip it.
Okay, so this is a moot. So we will simply disregard that one. And item number two is the planner's report. What's going on over there?
Really have nothing new to report. I just would note that I know a few members have attended various trainings. And I'll try to keep bringing this up, but I will try with staff here to create a spreadsheet noting what everyone's done and get that out to folks. So if there's anything we're missing, you can let us know, and then you can get, you know, a little more info on where you are if you've forgotten. And I'll also include there's some online resources in terms of some of the trainings that some people went to live that are still available. Streaming, so we can. I'll let you know where those are. I mean, it's only 4 hours of training, so I think, you know, over the next few months, so hopefully everyone can punch this out and can be in full compliance with the new state law.
Harry, Massimo Liguori here. I actually went on the affordable housing education event that Chuck Anders was on.
Oh, great!
Yeah, and there was nothing where I could have, you know, signed into or
out. Yeah, and it's all an honor system. So you're just letting us know. We'll add you to the chart that you've done that hour, and that's great.
Okay, yeah. Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you.
Thanks, Harry. Anything else?
I don't have anything else. Evan, is there anything you have that I'm covering? Okay. Seems odd. It's only 12:13.
Right. Harry, did you? I think you had mentioned there was a request from.
Yes, that's right. I forgot about that. We did receive a request from Attorney John Nuff regarding the proposed 436, I think, unit, possible PDD on the former Amazon site. They are requesting another opportunity to make a pre-application presentation to the commission. with potentially some more information from a real estate broker, economic development firm. I think they requested to do it on the 1st of June. It probably, frankly, makes more sense to have as many of the full-time commissioners available as possible, so I can let them know that the commission would prefer it on the meeting on the 15th, if that's what the commission would like to ask them to do. But there is no provision in the regulations per se to have multiple pre-application meetings before PDD is submitted. Doesn't say you can't, just doesn't really provide for it either way. It says a meeting, which you already had. So it's up to you guys.
Thanks, Harry. I mean, my general thought is I have some concern with multiple pre-application meetings because there's an effort being made to get a decision before they even file an application. In other words, if you have a multiple series of meetings, that could potentially be that type of an issue of where, you know, before they even apply, you know, the issues without any public input and anything else. That said, I know that there was some, you know, even in the process, there was some expectation, I think, that maybe there would be one more chance to review and some further comments. So I don't necessarily oppose having another meeting, but that would be it. I mean, that I just don't, you know, think you can't just, I think I have just some concern process-wise for doing more than that. But anyway, those are my thoughts. What do other people think?
Hi, Marcy here. I have two questions. One, who wasn't at the original meeting that, you know, they might have missed the first one? And
No, it's okay. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Are they submitting new information?
I think they just want to make additional, new information, I think, in terms of more rationale presented for why PDD is what I got out of it. And I was just mentioning that I think all the full commission members were present at the last one. So to me, it'd make more sense to try to pick a meeting where everyone who's a regular commission member, full commission member, could be present.
In other words, they asked to go June 1st, so I'm not going to be here.
Yeah, right.
So why don't we have it when I'm here? I mean, I think that was
again, Marcy again. But was everybody, the full commission, present for the last one?
I believe they were.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, the full commission should be present regardless, but yeah. I mean, they should be presenting new information.
Right, right.
Make a decision whether they want to, you know, venture in with an application or not, based on, I think we gave them a lot of input.
I think there was no lack of input, yes.
Chuck, Fred Russo.
Fred?
I want to agree with you. I think that in principle, having more than one hearing, although there was an informal hearing, you know, is not a good precedent, but it is a pretty large project. And I would absolutely think that our chairman should be present on the date that it's heard. If we decide to hear it, fine. But I would just say this, being your substitute on the 1st, I think it'll be a very tough meeting to handle without you being there, quite honestly. So I think if this commission is going to entertain having a second informal hearing, there's no question in my mind that you should be there. And whenever that, unless you have another daughter that's going to get married, we'll have to postpone it again. But short of that, I think you should be there. That's important.
Sure. I guess, you know, I guess the initial question is, should you have a second one at all? And then, you know, who should be there and so forth. So does it, you're right. It is a fairly significant project, you know, and I have the process concern issue, and we did give them input, but, if we do it again, that's it. I mean, then you got to think, that's sort of where I'm at.
Hi, Chuck, it's Marcy again. I have no issue hearing them again. I just would not like to hear the same thing again. Yeah. And I do think that you need to be present. So if it's new information and you can be there, you know, I have no issue. But again, I think, you know, it needs to be something that we haven't heard.
Sure.
Yeah. You know, so.
And my hope is that it's information and not marketing seduction. there was an awful lot of trying to soften us up with, you know, very, very, very dense marketing language in the last presentation that was pretty much lacking planning substance. And I don't know, I hope they don't do that again, because, you know, like Marcy is going to start to understand real soon, at a certain time of the night, the dog wants to go out. And you don't see what's going on in the screen beneath the table. But yeah, I would, you know, do we give them a second bite at the apple? Yes, if they're going to come with something substantive, I could put up with that.
Thanks, Joe. Any other thoughts or comments? Okay, then I'm happy with that, you know, we would allow them, but they would have to have new information, it'd have to be substantive information, and it's the last one. Don't ask for a third one.
Fair enough.
Okay.
And
I will convey that to Attorney Nuff.
Right. Okay.
I think that's it, unless it's something else I'm forgetting too.
Okay. Anything else from anyone else?
I have one thing to say before we conclude. Sure, I want to congratulate you on the wedding of your daughter. We won't see it till after the wedding, but congratulations.
Thanks, Fred. And good luck running the meeting. I'll make sure.
I don't know who's got the bigger job that day, me or you, but I'll do my very best.
Congratulations.
I want to thank Fred for taking over the role of the secretary, so I didn't have to.
Oh, well, thank you, Marcy.
Important excursion. Oh.
That's great. I'm going to start taking more time off because
All right. Well, okay. Do we need a motion or?
Yeah, motion to adjourn.
I'll make a motion to adjourn.
My motion to adjourn made by Fred. Is there a second?
Chadwick seconds.
Second by Joe Chadwick. Any further discussion? All in favor of adjourning? Joe Chadwick.
Chadwick is in favor of adjourning and wants to know when we're going to be seeing Marcy at Young's Pond.
He's got to get his shots first. I'd be happy to bring him. And some teeth, maybe.
Okay.
He's very bitey right now. He probably wants to go outside, like you said.
Fred, are you in favor?
Fred's in favor.
Joe Vayuso.
Vayuso in favor.
Marcy.
Marcy's in favor.
And Chair is also in favor, so we are adjourned. Thank you,
everyone. Good night, everybody.
Good night, everyone.
Good night. Good night.
This program was brought to you in part through the support of the Town of Brantford. Watch town meetings and other videos on demand at BrantfordTV.org.